A soldier is very scared. And what is he scared of? A soldier is very scared of sentiments. I'm sorry. Okay, I'm all right. A soldier is scared of praises. And today, I think I have had more than my share of it. On behalf of the soldier, I wish to thank you all. Not very many in this country do this with the kind of sincerity that she is doing, and I think she deserves all the praises for that. Who actually puts across ideas and messages in the most effective manner. Thank you, sir. I'm also grateful to Tiru Shankar Narayan, who happens to be a friend, and hopefully one day he shall be my neighbor, for giving me this opportunity of coming here to be in amongst you all on such an energizing kind of a topic. I must congratulate each of the speakers for the energy with which they spoke, the passion with which they spoke, and the conviction with which they spoke. Congratulations. And I must confess, I have so much of faith in you, the youth of our country, that I decided that I'll take 10 books as prizes, because all of you are winners, all of you are first. So therefore, I decided not to bring just 3 or 2 or 1, but to bring 10. And if I had my way, I would have brought 162 to give it to all participants who participated in this debate. My heartfelt respects to the most distinguished personalities who are the judges today. For want of time, I shall refrain from naming each one of you. The young, inspired minds and hearts, the young people sitting behind, and the very smart and most befitting representatives in among the youth, the NCC cadets, who gave me such an amazingly good guard award. Thank you very much. I wanted to just clarify a few issues as a soldier. This is my 39th years of soldiering. I've done 39 years of soldiering. And soon, in the next about 6 or 7 months, I shall superannuate and quietly fade away. But what is it that makes a soldier decide that he needs to sacrifice himself, dedicate himself to the nation? There are a few heartfelt sentiments that he holds very dear to his heart. Possibly this may not have been ignited right from the day that he became a soldier, but it happens over a period of time. It's a transition. And the first is the nation. And when we say nation, it's not just the real estate, it's not the land, it's not the mountains and the forest. The nation basically consists of the people who reside in that area. So that is that heart, that these are my countrymen. And why is it that sentiment is so strong in among soldiers? It is because of that one single reason, that he knows that these people have reposed that faith in him to do his bit to protect the country, to protect them from the harm's way, whether it is from the external sources or from internal sources. That is one of the main reasons as to why he gets ready to sacrifice himself. The second is, as we say, the flag. The flag is not necessarily just a symbol. It is much more than a symbol. As a matter of fact, the flag is a pride that he carries. That pride that this is my nation and no one shall harm it. These are my people who need to be protected. I am an Indian and I shall not let anything make me bow down before anybody. That pride makes him give the ultimate sacrifice of his life. And last of all, and the most important, is his comrades. Why the comrades are so important is because each one knows the other is looking out for his back. My welfare and my happiness and my survival is dependent on my comrade who is next to me. He protects me. He takes care and he makes sure that I am safe. And this belief that my comrade is the one who is protecting me makes me feel that I have a duty to make sure that I protect him in return. And that camaraderie actually drives you. In battle, possibly it is that camaraderie that drives you even harder than nationalism or the pride of the flag. That camaraderie is the most important aspect that a soldier carries when he is in battle. Now, when you talk about a nation, the sacred land that sustains us like a mother, our country, we who depend, and all those people who depend on us, is of course an important aspect of what nationalism is all about, the flag that I told you about, and the camaraderie. Now, I'll give you an example of how the soldiers have fought in the past, and what they did, and what was the reason that they did it. Dr. Shankar was just now speaking of the very, very glorious military history of Tamil Nadu, which is so little known outside Tamil Nadu. It's a very unfortunate fact. If you were to go up north and ask anyone of the army people or the naval people, who was Veerabandi Kattabomman, people do not know. Who were the Marudu brothers, people don't know. Now, when we talk about Marudu brothers, why did they do what they did? They did it because of the flag. They did it because of the people, the pride that they had in themselves as a clan. They had the pride to say that we shall not be subjugated by the Nawabs and the British. We shall continue to be free. And that, despite knowing that the chances of victory was very remote, even then they fought on. The great Marud brothers, who were the inventors of many an aerial weapon systems, which people don't even talk about today. I think I've made a note of it somewhere here. Vellarai, I hope I pronounced it right. Vellarai is a weapon system which they threw at the enemy, which hit the enemy and came back, something like a boomerang. And Britishers have chronicalized this fact that there were many British soldiers who learned the art of Vellarai from the Marud brothers when they were prisoners. From one soldier to another, they were so impartial that they never hesitated in teaching a skill even to the enemy. That is the kind of honorable people they were. Now that is the pride that they carried that made them fight and give up their life. Of course, the story goes that both the brothers were killed one after the other. They were executed by the British after having been caught and kept under custody. And then of course you come to the very famous Battle of Saragada, fought many years ago, in close to about two centuries ago. It was fought in Afghanistan. 21 Sikh soldiers held back attacks by thousands of Afghans. Why did they do it? Whom did they do it for in the first place? They did it for the British. Why this allegiance to the British? Why did they have to fight so hard for the British? It was not the British that they were worried of. It is not as to who they were fighting for. They fought for the pride. The pride that they were soldiers and they have been given a task, and that task shall be done. That is the kind of a spirit that a true soldier has. Thiru Sivam mentioned that one of the greatest attributes of the Indian soldier is that unlike Pakistan, we have not resorted to military rule. But that spirit should not be in any soldier for that matter. If it is there in Pakistan, possibly they do not have the true spirits of a soldier. A soldier will obey orders irrespective of who's at the helm. whether it is the Congress or DMK or Bharatiya Janata Party, it doesn't matter. It is the government and they order us, and we are subservient to the polity and to the bureaucracy and to the national governance. Now that pride is what carried these 21 soldiers of Saragari. And when Saragari battle was fought, it was fought to the last man, last round. Not a man survived. And there was not a weapon available to fight with. And that is the limit to which they fought. And they saved the day. Otherwise, there would have been a major problem for the British. And much of the frontier province would have been lost to the rebels of Afghanistan. And then, of course, is the Battle of Asal Uttar. The Battle of Asal Uttar, which is very close to my heart, because there, one of the recipients of the Paramveer Chakra, Abdul Hamid, CQMH Abdul Hamid. What was the cause that drove Abdul Hamid to give up his life? As a recoilless gun detachment commander, he destroyed two tanks. And when a recoilless gun is used, immediately you can find out that the recoilless gun is in such and such a place, and it's very easy to destroy it thereafter. But he didn't worry. He knew he'd get killed. He was very sure that he was going to be hit and wounded and finished off. But he just didn't hesitate. He hit one tank, moved out, hit the second one, and when he was in the process of moving out to hit the third one, he was in return hit by one of the Pakistani tanks, and he blew up, and he died, and he was given the Paramveer Chakra. Now, what was his reason? Asal Uttar is a small village, which is approximately about 20 kilometers from Amritsar. If on that day in Cape Kharan sector, Abdul Hamid had not done what he had done, possibly Amritsar would have been permanently lost to the Pakistanis. Now that love for the motherland, love for the people who were there in Amritsar, that drove him to give up his life. That is another example. And then of course, the very famous story of Ye Dil Mange More. The story of Ye Dil Mange More, of Batra, Vikram Batra, captured 5140, thereafter went ahead, captured 4875, and in the process of going to capture the third point called the flat top, he was wounded and he died. And when he told his commanding officer, "I want to go to the top, flat top, and capture it," his battalion commander said, "But why? You're already so tired, you're already wounded, and you're not good enough to go up there." And that is when he said, "Ye dil mange more. I want to do a little more. I'd rather die, but not give up." That is the kind of a spirit that drives a soldier. The necessity and the need to ensure the best for the country is what he gets. And finally, you have another grenadier officer of my regiment, Colonel Sarna. Colonel Sarna was the commanding officer of a unit which was fighting insurgency in J&K. When he saw the danger for his men, when he saw that his men were under threat, and when an entry had to be made into the room, he made that entry into the room. Both his legs were ridden with bullets. Approximately 42 bullets were fired at his legs. He was crippled. He was lying on the floor, but continued to hold the terrorists at bay till such a time his rest of the people could come and neutralize those two. He bled to death. Now, I'm giving you certain examples of people who are not necessarily Paramveer Chakra. There were people who probably didn't even get certain awards. And rightly, as was brought out by Thiru Sivam, it is not necessary that a person has to win a gallantry award. Possibly, it's not even necessary that a person has to win any award. It is the feeling. And let me tell you, my firm belief is that each one of you is a soldier. Each one of you is possibly as good as a soldier. The only difference between you and me is that I have taken to the defense of the motherland, you have taken to enhancement of development, enhancement of knowledge, of academia, of agriculture. So each one of you is a soldier fighting, and in your own areas, in your own field. It's just that we have taken the oath to defend this nation, and we seem a little different. But I thank you all from the bottom of my heart for having these amazing sentiments. I have known the sentiment to be there in each Tamil. I'm a Tamilian myself. It's not that it's not there. Only thing, it is latent. And we should be grateful to people like Sumati who are rekindling and bringing out that latent sentiments, love, affection, respect for the Army, Navy and the Air Force, for which we are, I'm most grateful. And finally, I would like to give you a small understanding of what the last post is about. You must have heard the last post in many funerals. The last post is blown. It's a bugle call. It's a very interesting story. It happened that there was an officer of the American Army who found that in the battlefield there was a dead body. So he felt that the honorable thing to do would be to get the dead body and give it a decent burial. When he went to the dead body and he turned the body over, to his absolute horror, he found that it was the body of his son. The father was fighting for the Continental Army. The son was fighting for the Confederates. So they were in opposing forces. He found his dead son's body there. His son was a musician. He picked up his son and brought him back, and he told his senior officers that, "I would like to give him a military burial or military funeral." It was refused. They said, "No, you can't give him a military funeral, he's an enemy." So he said, "At least let me get some musicians so that I can give him that burial." They said, "Okay, he's your son, you're permitted to take one musician." And he took a bugler. And in the process of burying his son, he found a small slip of paper in his son's pocket which had musical notes on it. And the bugler blew those notes. And that note that is blown is what is known as the last post. It's a very sad and a very melancholous kind of a tune. It has got certain lyrics to it, beautiful lyrics. Those of you who know how to Google and get the lyrics of the last post, you must listen to it. It's extremely enchanting. Thank you very much for doing the honor to the soldier. Thank you very much for doing the honor to me and my establishment, the Officers Training Academy. We are just as proud of each one of you as you have expressed your pride in us. Thank you very much. God bless each one of you all. Jai Hind.